HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Postmistress of Paris, a novel by Meg Waite Clayton, performed by Imani Jade Powers and Graham Halstead. For Anna Tyler Waite, who wasn't born an heiress, but built her own kind of fortune in her own way. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul. Emily Dickinson. I have traveled through many countries and learned to hide my thoughts in many languages. Hans Zahl. Part 1. January 1938. Once back in Paris, I learned that most Americans were scurrying home. I decided to stay on. I had lived in France for 8 years and felt a part of her. I had learned to love her people, her history, her landscapes, and her old stones. If the French could take it, so could I. Besides, too many extraordinary things were in the making, and I didn't want to miss out. Mary Jane Gold, Crossroads, Marseille, 1940. We should have left France after Max was arrested the first time, but we couldn't imagine a world other than Paris. Leonora Carrington, Villa Arbel by Rosemary Sullivan. Monday, January 17th, 1938. In the sky over Paris. The sky out the glass roof of her Vega gull was as crimson as the airplane. Beyond the windshield and the gray whirl of propeller, 10,000 tons of iron stood laced against the setting sun. Naneé called over the roar of the Gypsy 6 engine, "La dame de fer à son meilleur niveau." That's the kind of art I love. To Dagobert, her sole passenger, who wagged his unkempt poodle tail as they circled the Eiffel Tower. The Iron Lady at her best. She flew on up the looping Seine, headed back to Paris for the Exposition Internationale du Surréalisme. 300 artworks depicting gigantic insects, bizarre floating heads, and dismembered or defiled bodies she knew were meant to be thought-provoking, but always left her feeling unsophisticated and far too American. Midwestern. Not even from Chicago, but from Evanston. She loosened the white silk scarf at her neck, as she initiated a controlled descent from 1,000 feet to 800, 600, 5, to buzz her empty apartment on Avenue Foch. She loved Paris, if only its winter nights weren't so long, when you were 28 and living alone. She throttled back to idle and extended the flaps over the Bois de Boulogne, descending to 200 feet as she approached the park's lake, its small cascade and charming little emperor's kiosk. Up here in the air, there was no grumbling about Prime Minister Choton excluding socialists from the French government, no brother killing brother in Barcelona, no Hitler claiming to be eager for peace while all of Europe trembled. She dipped a wing for a better view, to see the trickle of water over rocks into frozen lake and, oh Lord! A span of black wings stretched to white-feathered tips at 10 o'clock. A red bill opened in a call of warning, inaudible over the engine, as she slammed the throttle wide open and yanked back the yoke, snapping to the right and climbing to avoid crashing into the black swan already diving to avoid her. But the nose of the plane was rising too quickly. Vertical speed, 1,500 feet per minute. Through the windshield, nothing but sky. The airspeed indicator plummeting toward stall speed, the wings buffeting as the plane began to lose lift, the stall horn sounding its alarming blare. She pushed the yoke forward, rolling out of the turn, sending the nose dipping in an effort to recover from the stall. Dagobert tumbled forward as the altimeter unwound and the plane shot downward, the view now pure propeller and frozen lake. The ice. So little room to maneuver. Poor Dagobert whimpering. The airspeed indicator at 45 knots, fingers aching from her grip on the yoke. It's okay, Dags. Her whole body tensed, about to splinter. 50 knots, 55. She willed the airspeed indicator to move faster so she could pull up again without stalling before she crashed into the ice. Faster, damn it! 60, 65. Pulling back on the yoke again, the pitch of the nose rising now, the attitude indicator moving toward level, so low she was nearly skimming the frozen lake. Her knuckles pale with her tight grip, but yes, she'd stopped the stall. She was flying straight and level. The airspeed indicator now at 70 knots. She retracted a notch of flaps, the plane sinking a little, and her stomach with it. She pulled back a bit more on the yoke, maintaining altitude. Dagobert looked up anxiously from the floorboard. Another notch of flaps. A little more on the yoke, initiating the climb out. 400 feet, 500. A last notch, and they were in a stable climb to 600, with time now to recover from anything new that might go wrong. Back at 1,000 feet, she circled, waiting for her damn heart to stop trying to escape her damn chest. The Seine looped soothingly from the west to the south and onto the east, to another view of the Eiffel Tower, more distant now. The frozen lake that might have been her cold grave, and that of Dagobert and the swan, too, circled back into view. All right, she said to Dagobert, still crouched on the floorboard, as rattled as her own nerves. She descended toward the lake again, this time to a less daring 500 feet, to run along the length of the water, past the waterfall and to the left of the island and the emperor's kiosk, its little blue dome so hopeful. And there he was, at the north tip of the lake, the black swan, settled safely on the ice. She ought not to have been flying so low, but that was what she loved. The high, open sky, yes, but also the rush of earth. That daughter of yours would rather be wild than broken. Don't you worry, she'll end up alone.
But I'm not alone, am I, Dags?
She patted the bucket seat beside her, shaking off her father's words.
I have you.
Dagobert reluctantly scrambled back up, then hunkered down on the seat, head on paws. She tugged on one of his velvety ears, and he shook his head that way he did whenever she messed with them.
I didn't mean to scare you, but I couldn't bear to hurt him, she said as she banked eastward, toward the landing strip at Le Bourget. And this is his world. He belongs up here.
She brought the plane to a stop on the tarmac and climbed from the cockpit onto the wing, already pulling off her goggles and leather helmet and shaking out her hair. She lifted Dagobert from the plane, the poor dog still trembling a little, and kissed him on his cold black nose. She set him on the wing, then pulled out her skis and her slim traveling case. Only then did she dare glance to the clock on the domed airport tower. She was impossibly late. She slid down to the tarmac, leaned her skis against the wing, and set her case on it, beside Dagobert. He watched attentively as she popped it open to its mirror-lined top, swapped her flight jacket for a purple wool with gilded beads and buttons, and added her fur cuff bracelet. Damn, it was cold, but at least there was nobody to see her. She looked in the mirror, then shrugged off the jacket and bracelet and tossed them on the wing.
She dug out a reliable old black Chanel dress and pulled it over her head, slipped her blouse off underneath, and let the silk fall into place over her leather flight pants. Better. Not warmer, but better. She added her flight jacket again, for warmth. Could she just wear the leather pants and boots with the dress? It was a surrealist exhibit, after all. Dagobert settled in, resting his head on his paws as she swapped her wool stockings for silk ones. She pulled on heels, added pearls. More pearls. Even more. She clipped the strands together with an oversized safety pin brooch, silver with a red bakelite accent, then unfolded a fabric crumple into an elegant hat. She touched perfume to throat and wrist and wrapped her flying scarf back around her neck. Not better, but warmer. She added the fur bracelet again, its brass underside cold. She applied lipstick, then took Dagobert's face in her hands. I don't want to go either, but it's for Danny. Danny Benedict, her French brother. She'd lived with his family when she first came to study at the Sorbonne years ago. Danny did so much good for so many. She kissed Dagobert twice in the French way, leaving red lipstick on his face. All right, she conceded. I'll drop you by the apartment. Dagobert licked the fur of her bracelet. That's Schiaparelli, Dags. Dagobert's look. She could wrap him around her wrist anytime she wanted, and at a fraction of the cost. She lifted him from the wing and set him on the tarmac. You are terrifically soft and beautiful, she said. But you would never sit still on my wrist. In the Galerie des Beaux-Arts courtyard, Naneé eyed Salvador Dali's rainy taxi, a vine-covered 1933 Rolls-Royce, with a male mannequin chauffeur wearing a shark's head and goggles in the driver's seat, and in the back, a gowned, sopping wet female one covered in live snails. A gallery attendant handed her a flashlight and opened the grated door to a surrealist street, lined with more female mannequins dressed, largely undressed, according to the fetishes of prominent artists, with a velvet ribbon gagging a mouth, a birdcage over a head. Unsettling laughter haunted the main hall, a dim, dusty grotto of a room with hundreds of coal sacks hung from the ceiling, a double bed in each corner, and a floor that was somehow all pond and leaves and moss without actually being wet. The source of the laughter was, she found, a gramophone devouring mannequin legs, titled Jamais. Never. Naneé was inclined to agree. A crowd was gathered around a display of photographs hung on freestanding revolving doors at the dim room's center. And there was Danny, all neatly slicked back hair and round black glasses, long nose, tidy mustache over a narrow, dimpled chin, with tea beside him, even smaller than her husband, her boy-cut dark hair and huge hazel eyes, more handsome than beautiful. Naneé threw her arms around Danny, then exchanged bee kisses with tea, la bise. Don't you look posh, T said. Naneé, who'd forgotten to take off the flight jacket and scarf, said, Do you like it? I'm calling this look Aero Chanel. She smiled wryly. Sorry I'm late. The winds were fierce. When are the winds in your life not fierce? Danny teased. The French writer, André Breton, stood in front of the revolving door photographs, clasping and unclasping his hands, as he finished an introduction and asked everyone to join him in welcoming Edouard Moss. Edouard Moss? The Edouard Moss photos Naneé knew were from newspapers and magazines. An adorable girl in pigtails enthusiastically saluting Hitler, a man having his nose measured with a metal caliper, A clean-chinned son taking scissors to his Orthodox Jewish father's beard. The forgiveness in the father's face, heartbreaking and raw. Edouard Moss's photojournalism, as well as his art, would have set Hitler against him, forcing him to flee the Reich.
"I thought you would like Edouard," Danny said.
"Edouard? That's awfully chummy, isn't it?" Naneé teased. Danny took such pleasure in befriending the artists he helped, quietly using his...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.